Have you written without seeing, or you have copied?
I have written mostly without seeing, ma'am.
Mostly.
Mostly, yeah.
Little you copied. See,
Yes, ma'am.
students, we trust you. We trust you. Kavya, what about you, Kavya? Kavya, see, if I ask any question to any student, then their network will be lost or what? Suddenly they'll be disconnected from the class, or my voice is not audible to them. What is this? Huh? How was the test? Have you all done the test? It was easy?
Yes, ma'am.
Easy. Yes, students, 5 minutes we'll discuss the test question paper, and then I'll move to my topic. What was the first question, students? First question, any though? First question is Tanya. What was the first question?
Ma'am, list out the benefits of .NET framework.
What are the benefits of .NET framework? Platform independent, cross-platform, ease of deployment, memory management. Okay, students, the first question was list out the benefits of .NET framework. What are the benefits of .NET framework? Cross-platform independent, scalability. Yes, what are the benefits? The benefits of .NET framework is cross consistent programming model, cross-platform support, language interoperability, automatic management of resources, ease of deployment. These are the benefits of .NET framework. Yes. Yes, students. These are the benefits of .NET framework. Yes, students, can you share, see my screen?
No, ma'am.
Good. One minute. I think now you can see the screen. Can you see the screen, students?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Now?
No, ma'am.
Yes, it is loading. Still, it is loading. I think now you can see. Yes, now you can see. Now you can see the screen, students.
No, ma'am.
Still, you cannot see.
Visible, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So the benefits of .NET framework, and the second question is draw and describe the .NET framework architecture. The see in the architecture I have shown three diagrams. One is for three diagrams I have shown you, and I told you which one, when you get an external exam or in your internals, which if you get this question, then what type of which diagram you have to refer or which diagram you have to write. I told you those who have written that diagram only, they will get the marks. And list out the operators, or I told you to list out all the operators and explain any four in detail. Then this, see, fourth question is very simple question. This is your lab-based program only I have asked. And here you have to demonstrate boxing, unboxing, and invalid unboxing. Yes, students, in the same program also you can demonstrate boxing, unboxing, and invalid unboxing. Few students have done boxing, unboxing one program and invalid unboxing in the other program, but few students have not done invalid unboxing. Students, you have to show invalid unboxing also, because in the question I have asked for boxing, unboxing, and invalid unboxing. And the fifth question is, this is also a very easy question, illustrate with a small example the following terms. Those are namespace, object, constructor, and destructor. All these keywords we have seen in our theory classes. So based on that only I have asked. And define property. Yes, students, when I ask you to define property, then you have to write the definition and the syntax. Many of you have not written the syntax. When you write the syntax there, you have to write the property syntax I have given, no, in the class. And the PPT also, the PPT which I have shared, knowing that also the property syntax is there. Few students have not written the property syntax directly. They have written the program. Directly have written the program. And case study and innovative question. See, students, in the case study, I told you to write the pseudo code to create a class and members of a class and write the relationship. Relationship, how many have you written relationship? How many of you have written relationship? And this is a simple eighth question, very simple case study question I have given. It was very simple. So I've already told, assume we are developing a library management. See, students, when I was explaining the namespaces there, I have clearly I have mentioned to draw any diagram, to show any two-dimensional or three-dimensional diagram, what namespaces we use for ADO.NET and for client server, for forms, what are the namespaces we have used, everything I have explained in detail. And here I have asked you, when we create a database with the necessary tables, what namespaces we use, and I told you to write the purpose of the namespaces also. Few students have written very well, and few on an average everybody have done well, but still you have to improve. So any doubt in the question paper? No, no. Students, we were seeing polymorphism. What is polymorphism? We were in polymorphism. Polymorphism is a very important concept of OOPS programming, OOPS object-oriented programming language. The polymorphism has two types, that is static polymorphism and dynamic polymorphism. Static polymorphism is also known as compile time polymorphism. Static polymorphism is also known as compile time polymorphism, and it is also known as overloading. It may be, yes students, if I say overloading, it may be function overloading, it may be operator overloading, it may be indexer overloading. How we overload function, how we overload operator, how we overload in the indexer, all these examples also we have seen in the last class. So polymorphism has two types, static polymorphism and runtime polymorphism. Static polymorphism and dynamic polymorphism. Static polymorphism is also known as compile time polymorphism, and overloading is the overloading. Again, we have three types. The overloading may be function overloading, operator overloading, and indexer overloading. Function overloading is nothing but method overloading. You can also call this as a method overloading. A function is nothing but method. A function is nothing but a method. So next we have dynamic polymorphism. Dynamic polymorphism is also known as runtime polymorphism, or overriding, method overriding. This, students, this is overloading, this is overriding. This static polymorphism is overloading, dynamic polymorphism is overriding. This dynamic polymorphism is a second type of polymorphism. It is also known as runtime polymorphism. The C hash allows you to create an abstract class that this abstract class we'll see in the next topic. So this C hash allows you to create an abstract class that are used to provide a partial class implementation of an interface. It implements in implementation is completed when a derived class is inherited from it. And this dynamic polymorphism is also referred as a runtime polymorphism, and it is also known as late binding polymorphism. Dynamic polymorphism is also known as late binding polymorphism because the decision is taken place during the runtime. So we call as a late binding polymorphism. The late binding polymorphism, because of the decision about which the method is called, is made at the runtime. Is somebody telling something? You want to tell something, students? You want to tell anything? This dynamic polymorphism is also known as late binding. Why we call this as a late binding is because the decision is taken place during the runtime. The decision about the method is taken during the runtime, and in dynamic polymorphism, we use override and virtual keyword. In dynamic polymorphism, we use override and virtual keyword. Yes, students, this is very important. In dynamic polymorphism, we use virtual and override keyword. The dynamic polymorphism is also known as late binding polymorphism. Why late binding polymorphism is the decision about the method is taken. The decision about the method we about the method, the decision will be taken during the runtime. The decision will be taken during the runtime. That's why we call this as a late binding polymorphism. And this dynamic polymorphism has virtual and override keyword. Virtual and override keyword. Here we'll see what is virtual and what is override. The virtual keyword. Virtual keyword is used for generating virtual path. This virtual keyword is used. Virtual keyword is used to generate the path for a derived class. This is virtual keyword is used to generate a path for the derived class on implementing method overriding. On implementing method overriding. Overriding. Virtual keyword is used within a set. Virtual keyword is used within a set with override keyword. Yes, students, when we virtual keyword is used with override keyword. Virtual keyword is used with override keyword. Yes, you can see here. Yes, yes, students, can you see the example? Base class. It's virtual. This is a base class. In the base class, I'm using this virtual. Yes, students, listen carefully. The virtual keyword is used with override keyword. The base class will be having a virtual, and the derived class will be having a override. See here, this is a base class. Yes, can you see this? A base class. A base class is what? Class A. Class A is a base class. Here I am displaying a message. I am displaying a message. Hello, base class. And this is a override. See here, students. This is a complete example. This is a complete example for virtual and override. In the base class, we are using virtual keyword. And in the derived class, we are using a override keyword. The derived class, we are using override keyword. Why we use this virtual override is, see here, the method name in the base class is show, and the method name in the derived class is also show. Yes, students, but both the methods are displaying a different output. This is the reason why we use virtual and override. The override keyword is used in a derived class. The override keyword is used in a derived class of a base class in order to override the base class method. In order to override the base class method, we are using the same method. See here, the base class has a virtual keyword with the method show, and the derived class has a override keyword with the same method. See, student, the derived class method will be having a same method name and same signature. The derived class method will be having a same method name and same signature. Yes, in the runtime polymorphism is also known as late binding. Why we call as late binding is because the decision is taken during the runtime, and in runtime polymorphism, we use virtual and override keyword. We use together. Virtual and override keyword we use together. The override keyword is used in a derived class of a base class. In order to override the base class method. In order to override the base class method, the override keyword is used. See here, the base class, in the base class I have show method, and even in the derived class also I have the same method with the same signature. Just a minute, student. I'll show you one more program. Yes, students, you can see this now. Can you see the Word document? Can you see the Word document? Respond. Is my Word document?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, students, here I have a base class. I have a base class. The base class is interest. The base class is interest. And I have created a derived class. This is a derived class is nothing but a child class. This is the first child class. This is the first child class. That is simple interest is a simple interest is a derived class. Simple interest is a derived class, and this is the first derived class. Yes, students, you observe here in the base class, I have a method. The base class will be having a virtual keyword. The base class will be having a virtual keyword, and the method of the virtual keyword is true bank. The method of a virtual keyword is true bank, and this is the simple interest is a derived class. So this is the first derived class, and I have one more derived class, that is fixed interest. See here, this is a override method in two derived class, and these two are the override method. The override method have same name and same signature. Signature means what, students? The parameter, the arguments which we are using in the method. Here in the base class, I have true bank with the two arguments, double, and even in the first derived class also I have double amount and double rate, and in the third derived class also I have the same argument, but the calculation is different in both the derived class. Yes, students, can you see, can you observe? Respond. The calculation is different in both the derived class. So here the override method, what it is doing? It is overriding a base class. Here, when you execute this program, it will not create any conflict. Though all the methods have the same name and same signature, it will not create any conflict. It will display the output clearly for all the, first it will display the output for interest, and next the derived class is for simple interest, and in the fixed derived class we are calculating the fixed interest. I'll show the output. Yes, students, can you zoom your screen and you check the output? You zoom your mobile screen and you check the output. Are we getting a same output for all the values or for all the methods? Because we have the same method name. Yes, the normal interest value is 5,500. The simple interest is 6,500 and the fixed interest is 7,000. So this is. Virtual and over. Next we have abstraction. Yes, students, this abstraction is very important concept in OOPS programming, in object oriented concept. This abstract is very important. This abstract is very important. And what is encapsulation? What is encapsulation, students? What is encapsulation? Encapsulation is nothing but it is a encapsulation. Whichever information is not necessary, whichever information is not necessary, then it will be wrapped, and whichever information is necessary, only that information will be accessed to the user. Yes, I gave that refrigerator example. Now when we go to any showroom to buy a refrigerator, then what information we can see, which all the things we can see, which all the things are visible to us, students? Only the information which is necessary for us. The capacity, how many compartments the fridge will be fridge is having, what is the color, what is the whether, how much voltage it is consuming. On the refrigerator you can see the star. You can see the star rating, no? If it is 5-star, then it will consume less power. If it is 3-star, then it is consume more power compared to 5-star fridges. Yes, students, have you observed this? Yes, only that information we see. We don't see what type of circuits they have used, which LED bulb, which machine, which type of how the wiring is done inside. That all the information is not seen by the common man. Correct, no? That may be seen by any mechanic. Those information may be needed to any mechanics, but for the common user that information is not necessary. Similarly, in abstraction also, it hides some concept. The abstraction is a process of hiding the details of a particular concept or particular object. In abstraction also, it hides a particular information. If some information is not accessed by the common user, if some information is not, it should not be accessed by the some X person. Assume that we have developed an application. When we develop an application, we give two logins. No, one is for admin and the other one is for user, because some of the permissions are not given to the user, that are hidden, that are wrapped, that are we have given some security, because of some security issues, some data while data manipulation. So we have given two types of login. Only the admin can access. Only the admin can do some functionalities like adding user, deleting user, modifying user. So the admin will be knowing the login credentials for both admin and user. But the user will not be knowing the login credential for admin. He knows only the login credential for user. So because only that information is necessary for him. Only that information is necessary for him. Because of that, only that information we have given. For admin, both admin and user login credentials are needed. So that's why we have given both credential to administrator. So to user, we have to user we have hided some information. So similarly in abstraction also, the abstraction is a process of hiding the details of a particular concept or object. And see here, this is the in abstraction we have abstract class. This is a syntax for abstract class. This is the syntax for abstract class. Yes, students, what is cannot be instantiated. What is cannot? What is the meaning of this? Cannot be instantiated. What is the meaning of this? Past means, see, the meaning, what we the meaning cannot be instantiated is we cannot create an object. We cannot create an object. So here the meaning of this statement is the abstract class cannot be instantiated, means we cannot create a object for abstract class. We cannot create a object object for a abstract class. See here, this is an example. This is syntax. This is syntax, students. From here, it is a syntax. Abstract is a keyword. Abstract is a keyword. Class is also a keyword. Class is also a keyword. And this is a base class. This is a base class. And here we have the members of. Here we have the members of abstract class. And here I have a derived class. Derived class. Derived class. And see, here we have the members of a derived class. We have a members of a derived class. And coming to the main class, yes, students, base class. Base class, here I have missed BC. Yes, base class BC means this is a, this BC is the object of base class. This BC is a object of base class and DC is a object of derived class. Yes, students, you're understanding? BC is the object of base class and DC is the object of derived class. Yes? Can you see, students? Respond. But as I told, in the beginning, you cannot create an object for, abstract class. You cannot create an abstract object for abstract class. But my base class is what? My base class is abstract class. Now, can I create an object for my base class? Yes, can I create an object for my base class? Yes, students, tell me. In the beginning, I am telling abstract class cannot be instantiated. Means abstract for abstract class, we cannot create a object. For abstract class, we cannot create a object. But here, till here, I have written the syntax. This is a abstract class. And here in the main class, what I have written is base class object and this is a derived class object. That's why here I have written cannot be instantiated. So you cannot create a object for, abstract base class. You can create a object for normal class, normal base class. But this is a abstract class. This is a abstract class. Yes, students, understanding? Yes, are you understanding, students? Yes, you cannot create a object for base class, but you can create a object for a derived class. We have some of the characteristics of abstract class. That is the restriction is the usage of a abstract class is restricted in some cases, and it allows you to define abstract class as well as non-abstract members. Yes, this is a abstract class. This abstract class allows you to declare or create a non-abstract also non-abstract class also it allows you to create, and it requires at least one abstract method. This abstract class, it requires minimum at least one abstract method. It requires at least one abstract method, and it restricts the usage of sealed keyword. It restricts the usage of sealed keyword. So these are all the characteristics of abstract class. The characteristics are, the in an abstract class you can declare any non-abstract members, or you can declare any non-abstract classes, and the abstract class should have minimum one abstract method, and the abstract class restricts the usage of sealed keyword. The abstract class restricts the usage of sealed keyword. Okay, students, understood? Any doubt? Any doubt, students?
No, ma'am.
Okay, students, I'll stop here. The program for this abstract class and abstract method we'll see in the next class. Now you answer for your attendance. Aditya, Ajay,
yes ma'am,
Amit,
yes ma'am,
Antima, Antima, Apurva,
yes ma'am,
Ashwini, Bindu, Divyesh, Gaurish,
yes ma'am,
Gautami, Gautami, Gunashekar, Harini, Surya,
present ma'am,
Nayana, Nayana, are you there? Nayana, idala. Nazma,
present ma'am,
Nidhi, Pradeep, Preeti,
present ma'am,
Rajesh, Sahadev,
present ma'am,
Saket,
present ma'am,
Santosh, Seema,
yes ma'am,
Sinchana, Sinchana is not there. Spurti, Shashank,
present ma'am,
Varsha, Yashashwini,
present ma'am,
Amruta,
yes ma'am,
Anusha,
yes ma'am,
Apurva,
present ma'am,
Siddharth,
Chetana? Kavya?
Present, ma'am.
Madhushri?
Present, ma'am.
Present, ma'am.
Sarfraz?
Present, ma'am. Present, ma'am.
Murgesh?
Present, ma'am.
Mani? Paresh? Paresh? Pooja?
Present, ma'am.
Prashant?
Present, ma'am.
Pratibha?
Present, ma'am.
Pratik?
Present, ma'am.
Sadhana?
Present, ma'am.
Shashank? Shraddha? Sridhar?
Present, ma'am.
Tanuj? Tejaswini?
Present, ma'am.
Umehani?
Present, ma'am.
Ashish? Vidya?
Present, ma'am.
Vishal?
Present, ma'am.
Okay, students. Any doubt in abstract class? You understood the definition of abstract class? Yes, students, abstract class, you cannot be instantiated. Means that you cannot create an object for abstract class, and abstract class should have minimum one abstract method, and abstract class restricts the usage of sealed keyword. Restricts the usage of sealed keyword. Yes, again somebody, Aditya absent, no? Aditya absent, Antima absent, Apurva absent, Bindu, Divyesh absent, Gautami absent, Gunashekar absent, Harini, I saw her, Harini, Nayana, Nidheep, Pradeep is also not there, no? Rajesh is not there. Santosh absent, Sinchana absent. Varsha, Varsha, are you there, Varsha? Siddharth? Chetana is not there.
Ma'am, present, ma'am, got disconnected, ma'am. Okay. Network problem.
Mani? Mani is there. Paresh? Paresh? Paresh is not there. Shraddha? Shashank? Shraddha, Shashank is not there. Tanuj? Ashish? Okay, students, I'll stop here. See you in the next class.